Welcome to this YouTube channel, and today we are going to explain, we are going to discuss a small topic of evolution, that is Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium explanation. The contents of today's lesson, Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium or introduction, Hardy-Weinberg principle, conditions, Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium explanation. Let us get started. Friends, you know very well that evolution is a very, very gradual, slow occurring process. But how to visualize this organic evolution in our lifetime? Most of the authors say that it is quite impossible to visualize the organic evolution within our lifetime, but it is possible. Mathematically, it is possible. Statistically, we can understand the way in which the evolution is going on. Of course, we may not be able to find out all of a sudden from a new species originated in gradual course of time. Of course, in some mechanisms like mutation, all of a sudden a new species can be formed, but in most of the cases, formation of new species or origin of species is a very, very slow process. It's a gradual process. Let me give you a comparison. Say our Earth is revolving, but we may not experience it. We may not experience the way in which it is revolving, but we can understand, we can imagine. So we have certain other evidences like sun rising, sun setting, and based on that we can understand that it is revolving. Likewise, if evolution is a very slow process, definitely small changes occur in our lifetime in the population. Okay, if we can observe such a small genetic changes in population, we can expect the way in which evolution is moving. Okay, so to understand this, we need to have a concept. According to the scientists, especially Charles Darwin and Lamarck, according to them, they stated that because of individual effort, a new species can be formed. As Lamarck opined, because of a change happens in an individual, and that change will go to the next generation, and that change is very clearly visible, and because of the effort of that particular organism, because of use or because of disuse, the organism gets an acquired character, and that will pass on to the next generation. By that way, a new species is formed, according to that theory. So what is the main basis for that? An individual's effort. Likewise, if you can understand natural selection theory, where an individual is coming over the struggle, an individual is winning the struggle, and because individuals are winning, that individuals are selected. Okay, more individual effort is there, according to Darwinism. But friends, evolution does not occur at an individual level. Individuals may feel the changes, but population as a whole evolves into new population, and that new population gradually become a new species. So what is the unit of evolution? Not the individual. Evolution, unit of evolution is a population. Of course, a population is having lot of individuals, many individuals. Changes happen in individuals only. But that one particular individual is not going to become a particular species. Because of passing such changes, population as a whole changes to a new population, and this new population further changes into another new population like that. And at one stage, this group of individuals may not be able to breed with the other population where from they have come, so they are completely got isolated. In such a way, we can understand the process of evolution. Okay, evolution not only mean to form a new species, evolution is causing minor genetic changes within a species from generation to generation. What are those minor genetic changes that you need to observe? By observing those minor genetic changes, you can understand the way in which evolution is proceeding. Okay, the minor hereditary changes, those changes are leading to evolution. This is a new concept. We need to understand the minor genetic changes in a population, not an individual. Okay, so if you are observing a change in the individual, you may not understand all changes in the population. We need to take population as a unit. Then only we can understand what changes have happened among the individuals in this population, in what way the changes are happening, in what way the evolution is proceeding. Okay, so once again I repeat, individuals are feeling changes, but as a whole population evolves into a new population, and that will become a new species in the making. Okay, what are these minor changes, minor genetic changes? The minor genetic changes are nothing but the changes in the frequencies of alleles. For many genes, there are two alleles. Of course, for some genes, multiple alleles may be there. Okay, multiple allele resulted because of mutations. Okay, so let us see that a population has not undergone any mutation. So there are no multiple alleles. Let us assume. For one gene, there are two alleles. And these two alleles represent the entire population. Say there are 100 individuals. And one gene is having in 100 individuals. Every individual is having one particular gene. And this gene has two alleles. So the two alleles are representing 100 individuals. The two out of two alleles, one is the dominant allele and the other one is the recessive allele. If the dominant allele is representing 92% of individuals, and if the recessive individual is representing 8% of individuals, we can say that in this population, a dominant gene, the persons with the dominant gene are dominating. The trait is more dominant trait is appearing. Okay, so if this population is performing reproduction, and if you are observing in the next generation, there is a small rise in recessive population. So let us count the allelic frequencies now. If the dominant allelic frequency is 90 and the recessive allele frequency is 10, earlier it was 8, now it is 10. So we can understand that the population is moving to increase recessive character. Population is shifting from a dominant character, dominant trait, to a recessive trait. This small change, if you can observe, that change is nothing but a minor genetic change of evolution. If the change what has happened is useful, that means is it a useful variation, then it will be selected. And such individual number will be gradually increasing. In such a way, it will become survival, it will become the fittest, and it will be selected. So modern synthetic theory explains, or modern synthetic theory mingles Darwinian principle with the Mendelian principles. Mendelian principles are related to alleles, and a Darwinian principle is related to the useful changes. The useful changes, actually. So, evolution is proceeding towards the trait, recessive trait here, as I mentioned. Okay, if the trend continues, gradually the population is shifting from one side to the other side, and it may become a new species later because of certain other changes by mutations. Okay, so a very gradual process of evolution, we can notice that with the help of minor genetic changes. After getting this concept, okay, two scientists especially, Godfrey Hardy, an English mathematician, Wilhelm Weinberg, a German physicist, both of these scientists were attracted by Darwinism. They wanted to prove the occurrence of evolution with the help of mathematics. They conducted individual research in the year 1908. So they researched individually, and they came out with this equilibrium. This equilibrium is known as Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium. They proposed a principle, that is, the relative frequencies of various kinds of genes in a large sexual randomly mating populations tend to remain at a constant place, or tend to remain constant from generation to generation in the absence of mutation, selection, migration. Migration is gene flow. So they have given a principle that the allelic frequencies always remain in constancy. In constant. Allelic frequencies always remain constant. This is the principle. What are the alleles? For a gene, there are two alleles. And allelic frequency, number of individuals having dominant gene, is its frequency. Number of individuals in a population are having a recessive gene or recessive allele is recessive allele frequency. The two frequencies always remain in an equilibrium. Okay. The gene pool frequencies are inherently stable. In a gene pool, the totality of genes on a population. The totality of genes in, of a population. So, all such a gene pool, the frequent allelic frequencies of every gene almost all stable. But even if it is stable, we need to understand that evolution is going on. Evolution should be expected in all populations virtually all the time. Okay, so what it means is, for every population there are genes. Okay, that totality of genes is called gene pool. Every individual is representing a particular gene. So, that particular gene is present in all the individuals, and the gene is having alleles, and allelic frequencies are always maintained in a balance, and this is called equilibrium. This is called equilibrium. Okay. Evolution does not result, as I mentioned, as Lamarck and Darwin assumed at an individual level, but it results at the population level. When there is a gene and that gene is having two alleles, the allelic frequencies of this gene in a sexually reproducing population always remain in an equilibrium from generation to generation. I'll explain in the next slide. The genotypic frequencies, because for a gene there are two alleles, and these two alleles in different combinations form genotype. There may be homozygous dominant genotype, heterozygous genotype, and homozygous recessive genotype. As the allelic frequencies remain in an equilibrium, we can also expect the genotypes which are formed as a result of alleles the genotypic frequencies also remain in an equilibrium. Allelic frequencies remain equilibrium. Genotypic frequencies also remain in an equilibrium. And whenever the equilibrium is disturbed by any disturbance, then we need to understand that the population is changing. Okay. When the equilibrium got disturbed, new equilibrium is established at the disturbed equilibrium. So, population is moving from its original equilibrium to a new equilibrium. A particular population is now changed to a new population. In such a way, we need to understand the process of evolution. Okay. So, in order to establish the equilibrium in a population, Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium in a population must possess certain conditions. Okay. Of course, these conditions are not available or not possible to have these conditions, but an ideal population should possess all these conditions to maintain the equilibrium. But all the populations around us are not maintaining equilibrium because they are not satisfying all these conditions. If any population satisfies the following conditions satisfying all the conditions, that population never changes, never undergo evolution. But virtually what's happening, all populations are undergoing evolution. Okay. If any population is meeting these conditions according to Hardy and Weinberg, that population will not change. Okay. And if you are noticing disturbance of equilibrium, you are noticing the evolution process. So, in such a way, we need to understand. Okay. What are the conditions to maintain Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium by a population? The first condition is population must be a very, very large size. The population is infinitely large. You see, when population is very large, a small disturbance may be a negligible one. So that we can see that there is no disturbance occurred. Even if a small disturbance occurred, this small disturbance is almost all negligible. That is why the population seems to be stable. Okay. So, population must be a very, very large, infinitely large. This is impossible for any population in the world. Okay? All the populations, you see, you take any species, you take for example human species. Human beings are living in different populations, Indian population, American population, like that. So, infinitely large, living in an infinitely large population is almost all impossible. Because large population is not there for humans, equilibrium is impossible. When equilibrium is impossible, humans are undergoing evolution. Okay? So, when there is no equilibrium, it means that the allelic frequencies are changing. When allelic frequencies are changing, we need to understand that a population is undergoing changes. When population is very, very large, it facilitates all formation of all possible zygotes. When population is small, limited types of zygotes are formed. So that's why when all possible zygotes are formed, then all possible allelic frequencies are there or are resulted. So the first condition, population must be very, very large in size. Then only Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium is established. And the second condition, to establish Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium, the individuals of population must follow panmictic matings or random matings. The random matings means one individual can mate with any other individual, so that the frequencies, the movement of alleles in all possible ways can occur. But what is happening, even in animals, panemictic mating does not occur. Preferential mating occurs. Because of preferential matings, allelic frequencies, as I mentioned in the earlier example, that 8% recessive allele in the next generation became 10%. So the allelic frequencies gradually move, disturbed because of assortative matings, preferential matings. Okay, so the second condition that a population must possess is a random mating. That's almost all impossible. When random mating is there, all possible genotypes are formed. All genotypes are equally viable. It is also not possible. Okay, what is the third condition? All the individuals in a population must breed. So all must reproduce. That is the third condition. That means there must not be any generation gap. Generations must not overlap. All people, all individuals must possess same age. Is it possible? It's almost all impossible. That's why allelic frequencies are subjected to changes. Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium in normal in population is getting disturbed. Hardy-Weinberg population disturbing means evolution is going on. Okay. And the next condition, there should be no differential reproductive success. Every individual must possess or produce same number of progeny. Is this possible? No. For some couple, more individuals may be born. Their reproductive capacity is more. For some, the less number of children are formed. So this must not be the case for Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium. Okay, that's why the population which is maintaining Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium is said to be an ideal population. An ideal population is not at all existing. In order to understand the process of equilibrium, the process of evolution, we need to understand Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium at ideal conditions. Okay. We are living in such a condition that our allelic frequencies are subjected to changes. Okay, upon careful observation, we can find what are the changes that are happening in our lifetime, so that we can expect in what direction our species is evolving. Okay, so the next condition is there must not be any mutation, because mutation changes allelic frequencies. When mutation occurs, allelic frequencies got disturbed. When allelic frequencies are disturbed, naturally Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium will be disturbed. And when Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium is disturbed, population becomes new population. So mutation is making new population. And next condition is there must not be any natural selection. Natural selection must not operate on this population. It's almost impossible on every population. Natural selection is operating, and only those individuals are having useful alleles are selected. Okay, there should not be any change in the gene pool. That means disturbance in the gene pool because of gene flow. Okay, gene flow means nothing but migration. Okay, so these seven conditions are almost all impossible for a normal population. Number one, populations are very small, but here, in order to establish Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium, population must be very large, but our species populations are very small. Okay, then random matings must occur according to this theory, but substitute differential matings are going on. Next, so all individuals must breed. No, it's not possible. So homogeneous age is not there. Okay, some are old, some are young, like that in normal populations. There should not be any differential reproductive success. No, there are differential reproductive success. No mutation, but mutations are universal, natural. No natural selection, but on every population a force of natural selection is occurring. No migration, but here there is migration. So that's why all the populations are deviating from Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium, okay, by chance or by natural selection or by any process. But in a particular time, if you are calculating the frequencies, the frequencies remain to be constant. You need to compare this equilibrium constancy with the next equilibrium, next generation equilibrium. Then you will understand the change, what has happened, whether Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium is still continuing or Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium got disturbed. If it got disturbed, we have to come to a conclusion that evolution occurred. So let us see how it can be calculated. Hardy and Weinberg explained their principle of allelic frequency constancy and genotypic frequency constancy to develop a very, very simple equation, okay, to discover the probable genotypic frequencies, to track the changes, genetic minor changes from one generation to another generation. If you can calculate the frequencies according to this principle, you can track the changes of evolution, which are going to which are considered for evolution. Okay, let us deduce this one. Let us take first Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium is related to allelic equilibrium, genotypic equilibrium. The alleles of a gene with two alleles, always the allelic frequencies always remain constant. The genotypic frequencies remain constant, and this can be represented with a very simple equation. Let us see that. When a gene is having two alleles, let's see carefully here. When a gene is having two alleles, what are the two alleles? A dominant allele, capital A, recessive allele, small a. Okay. Now, the frequency of, let us assume, the frequency of dominant allele, capital A, is P, and the frequency of recessive allele, small a, is Q, let us think. Then, the two frequencies always remain under constancy, or they remain constant. So, how can it be expressed? P and Q are in equilibrium. So, it can be expressed like this. P plus Q is equal to a constant number. P plus Q is equal to 1. And P plus Q whole square is also constant. So, if you want to calculate the P, it is very easy. So, P is equal to 1 minus Q, because P plus Q is equal to 1. Or Q is equal to 1 minus P, because P plus Q is equal to 1. Or else, let us understand, this is allelic frequencies. For a gene, there are two alleles. These two alleles remain under constant condition. So, when P and Q are there as frequencies, P plus Q is equal to 1. P plus Q whole square is also equal to 1. It is simply binomial expression. P is equal to 1 minus Q, and Q is equal to 1 minus P. This is about allelic frequency explanation. Let us see the genotypic frequency. You know very well, a gene with the two alleles, capital A and small a, in their combination, capital A, small a combination, you will get three genotypes. How three genotypes? A and A, homozygous dominant. A in combination with the small a, capital A, small a, heterozygous. Small a in combination with the capital A, small a, heterozygous. Small a with the small a, that is homozygous. Homozygous recessive, heterozygous, and homozygous dominant. Okay. Capital A is already represented with the P, but here capital A into capital A is there. Two capital A's are there. So PP, P into P. So here one capital A, one small a. PQ, PQ, small a, QQ. So PP represents P square plus PQ, PQ, 2PQ plus Q square is equal to a constant number. So what is P square? Frequency of homozygous dominant. What is 2PQ? It is the frequency of heterozygous genotype. Q square is the frequency of homozygous recessive. The frequencies of genotypes remain in constant. Okay, number. The allelic frequencies remain always constant. Genotypic frequencies remain always dominant. Okay, if this is the expression, if you want to calculate P, P is equal to, you see, if P square is given, P A into A, number of individuals with a homozygous dominant, if it is given in the problem, if you want to calculate P, when the number of homozygous dominant are given and heterozygous are given, it's very simple. So, P is equal to number of homozygous dominant individuals plus half the number of heterozygous individuals you see here. So, P means AA, but here only half A is there. So, one other A is there, that's why P is equal to capital A, that means homozygous dominant individuals plus half heterozygous individuals divided by total population. Frequency, if you want to get frequency, divided by total population. If you want to calculate Q, number of individuals possessing a recessive traits plus half the number of heterozygous individuals divided by the total number of population, then you will get the frequencies of dominant allele, frequencies of recessive allele. Okay, right, friends. So, this is the small explanation related to Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium. Thank you. Thank you for watching this video.